Hey everyone, welcome back to the Sports Psych Show. Thanks so much for joining me. Today I'm excited to be talking all things coaching, skill acquisition, new coaching models with Kevin Smith, Dr. Con Burns and Dr. Ed Coughlan. Gentlemen, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Dan.
Thanks for having us, Dan.
Super excited to have you on. We're going to be unpacking a paper you've recently written together with a whole bunch of stellar names. But to get us started, let's do some introductions. Ed, we'll be reintroducing you. You're a regular on the show, but let's start with yourself, Kevin. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Thanks for having us on, Dan. So at the moment, I'm a PhD researcher in the Munster Technological University here in lovely Cork. My background, I graduated in 2010 with a bachelor degree in sports science from the University of Limerick. I went straight into industry after graduating and spent, I took up an internship in professional rugby in France with Stade Francais as a strength and conditioning coach. I was very fortunate to spend a very up and down 7 years over there, as is the case in France. Can be quite chaotic at times. I then kept in contact with one of my other supervisors, Dr. Keane O'Neill, who had recently taken up the position here in Cork, and spoke to him about a PhD opportunity that was down here, exactly what I'm pursuing at the moment, and was very happy to take up that opportunity back in 2018. So that's along the way then. Yeah, just coaching as part of the Cork senior football inter-county team as well, here in the city.
Brilliant. Kevin, it's fantastic to have you on. Dr. Con Burns, great to have you on. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hello, Dan. Thank you. And greetings from a nice, cold, but dry Cork. So I suppose a little bit about myself, Dan. I grew up here in Cork, and like a lot of young boys in Cork, lived and breathed everything sport related. So I suppose for me, a natural pathway was to look for a career in sport. So and in health and well-being. So I qualified as a physical education teacher in the University of Limerick, and I taught for a number of years in the secondary school environment. And from there, I progressed on to conducting my master's research in what is now the Southeast Technological University in Waterford. And it was in and around kind of physical activity promotion in children. And from there, I progressed to my PhD research, which expanded into that in that area and looked at correlates of participation in both physical activity and sport in youth. While in Waterford, I started lecturing in physical health and well-being promotion, as well as in the domain of coaching science. And then in 2007, I moved up here back to Cork into what was CIT, which will become MTU, Munster Technological University, and have been here since. I suppose coupled with my teaching, I suppose I'm also coaching heavily, right from my own children at under six, right up into adult level. So have been involved in that and I suppose teaching in the area of coach development with a lot of our students here. And over the last number of years, we've grown and developed a research profile within the department. So have been lucky to work with the likes of Ed and Kian, and we've grown and developed coaching science, skill acquisition research extensively in that time.
Wow, it's absolutely fantastic to have you on, Colin. You actually threw me there when you introduced Cork as being cold and dry at the moment. It's usually cold and wet there.
That was yesterday, Dan, and I just had it tomorrow.
Right, that was yesterday. I've missed that one by a day. Brilliant. Wow, listen, none other than Dr. Ed Coughlan. Ed, welcome back to the show. How are you?
Yeah, good, Dan. Thank you. So, yeah, for anyone who doesn't know me, Ed Coughlan, senior lecturer here in the Department of Sport, Leisure and Childhood Studies at MTU, and teach across the sports science and coaching science modules, but I'm engaged heavily in the research around skill acquisition and coaching science. So really looking forward to this, as I've always looked forward to our chats, Dan, because they always throw up some things that I'm not expecting. So away we go, as they say.
Well, you can add to your mini biography the co-host of the Sports Site Show, I think. No, it's wonderful to have you back. Look, super excited to unpack a paper you've written, as I say, alongside some pretty fantastic names. And I suppose coming to you, Kevin, here, before we talk about this paper, you mentioned your background in rugby, and really that's going to be the backdrop here for this paper, because it is within a rugby environment that you write this paper, and your work is within, and you have a rich background in rugby. And it's fair to say that Irish rugby is in pretty rude health right now, is it not? You're number one in the world right now, aren't you?
Yeah, absolutely. The national team is doing great things at the moment. Obviously, with a lot of very able people in the background and progressing it on. The provinces are in rude health as well in the European competitions, and even behind the scenes, which is when we talk about the paper, the work that is going on that is perhaps unseen with the IRFU trying to get their ducks in a row and ensuring that it's not just the main stage, or whatever you want to call it, that everyone sees, where the quality is being poured into. It's absolutely happening behind the scenes as well, and they seem to be reaping the benefits of processes and structures that have been put in long before the results start to come to fruition, you know.
Exciting times, and it's really important for me to emphasise that's on the men's side of the game. We've recently had the Women's World Cup, haven't we? A fantastic final, New Zealand versus England, where the English team just fell short of an incredible victory. On the men's side of the game, your national team are world number one. Now, this paper is entitled How to Coach. But that's a bold start to a paper, isn't it? How to Coach, a review of theoretical approaches for the development of a novel coach education framework. Before we unpack this, Kevin, talk to me about the genesis to this paper.
Yeah, so I suppose the best place to start with this was the initial approach. And I actually wasn't present at the time.
Okay.
The initial approach from the IRFU to Ed and Con here, in terms of they had designed a preliminary framework of, as the title says, of how to coach, with the aim of introducing, say, a more holistic type framework around how coaches were coaching, as opposed to what necessarily coaches would be coaching in terms of coach education, where the institute here, MTU, would come in is, say, we're looking at actually evaluating the framework that the IRFU have put forward, around if the framework itself is theoretically valid, which is obviously the purpose of the paper that you see in front of you, and the where I'll come in there afterwards then with the research is, does the framework have an effect on how the coaches are coaching in a practical setting with their athletes. So kind of a marriage between theoretical approaches and practical approaches, and is it effective is the big question.
We love that marriage. It can be a difficult marriage, right? It can be a challenging marriage. I mean, coming either to yourselves, Ed or Con, what I'm hearing there is the Irish Rugby Football Union approached you guys and said, hey, look, we've got this framework here. Can you, I suppose, unpack this framework a little bit, and then, well, just in very simple terms, and then we'll dive a little bit deeper into the theoretical approaches that are spoken about in the paper. But what first conversations did the IRFU have with yourselves, Ed and Con?
Yeah, I suppose we met with both Nick Winkleman and Matt Wilkie at the time, and they had the framework, I suppose, pretty developed, and through, I suppose, somewhat of an iterative process within the IRFU, and from speaking with coaches and from their own observations and from, I suppose, a somewhat preliminary review of the literature, they felt that there was merit in a focus on the how to coach as opposed to the what to coach. And I suppose that's where we felt, well, before we, I suppose, explore an intervention where this framework is rolled out, it's really important that we investigate rigorously the current literature that exists. And I suppose that was the genesis of this paper, and this review of literature. And from this, then it led on to the subsequent parts of Kevin's work that he's currently working through, where we've rolled it out and we're evaluating it. So that's kind of, I suppose, the story behind where this paper came from and where it all started.
Ed, coming to you, what I'm hearing there is how to coach rather than what to coach. Doesn't sound revolutionary, does it, mate? But I'm guessing it might well be.
Yeah, I think that's a big part of what a lot of coaching and coaches experience, is that when they start coaching, they coach the way they were coached. And very often, they're maybe thrown in at the deep end as a volunteer, assistant or parent coach. And it's very much prescriptive, and it's very much, I need to keep control of the session. And that's what coaching, essentially. But the how to coach, the connection of trying to have behaviors emerge as a result of engaging with people is a much more challenging thing. And I think when you look at the framework that was presented by Nick and Matt, so much of this will have probably came. You mentioned the word genesis earlier. We have to appreciate that, you know, Nick Winkelmann, who you know well, he would be regarded as one of a global kind of thinker in the space of the language of coaching. His own book, The Language of Coaching, has had a huge impact on people's approach to coaching. You know, so even within the framework, there's those explicit learning theories. That's a significant part of this framework, where his own work on cueing and effective cueing before an action even takes place would have probably been a starter for him, and then in time, Matt, to develop a framework like this. So there was a deep foundation in his own work that started that process for them within the IRFU, and that they began to layer in the other elements of the framework when we started looking at the implicit learning theories, let's say around maybe constraints-led approach to coaching and the like, and also then the self-determination theory and how we actually can encourage that autonomy and connection with the players. So I think as a starting point, it probably all started from Nick's work at the coalface of trying to engage with people through more efficient coaching language, let's say. And what he probably, as I know he would say, is the less we can actually talk to them about it and actually have them engage with some powerful cues, the more they're engaging in the action as opposed to trying to follow exactly what you want them to say and it becoming very explicit. And I think that's something that has probably emerged then as they started engaging with us and we started having chats about the framework that they presented to us.
Really fascinating, Ed, and you alluded to a few of the, you know, specific theoretical approaches that are involved in the framework, which Kevin's going to help us unpack in a second. But you also mentioned the name of Nick Winkelmann, and remiss of me not to mention the co-authors here. So, Kevin, you led the review paper here, ably assisted by yourself, Con, and Ed. You guys are here today, but also big shout out to Kian O'Neill and John Duggan, Nick Winkelmann, as you said, and Matthew Wilkie. So it sounds like Nick Winkelmann and Matthew Wilkie from the Irish Rugby Football Union approached yourself, Ed, and yourself, Con, with this new coach education framework, and it requires a bit of investigation, a bit of exploration. Is this efficacious? From an empirical perspective. Over to you, Kevin, in terms of, Ed mentioned something about implicit learning and explicit learning there, but can you unpack that for us? What theoretical approaches does this framework contain?
Yeah, so it's, I suppose, the easiest way I can use to describe what the framework actually entails, it's educating coaches in how they actually design their training session content to ensure that it's representative of what that athlete is going to experience in a competitive environment. It again educates the coaches on the language that they use, as we alluded to earlier, the language that they use with their athletes so that it's effective in getting their coaching message across, and not just usually the classic say it more often, say it louder, or say it a little bit more aggressive in some cases, depending. And then finally, the final piece of the puzzle is how can they foster and cultivate relationships with their athletes to ensure that they're adequately motivated, some level, or and have some level of autonomy within their own training process, and that there's actually that connection between the coach and the athlete so that they can develop together, essentially. So you're, how you speak, how you design, and how you connect would be the ladybird or the shorthand version of the framework.
I was about to sum it up, but you summed it up far better than me there. How you speak, how you connect, how you design. Brilliant, brilliant. And again, coming to, I mean, that's such a crucial trifactor, isn't it, when it comes to coaching? Design, speaking, language, connection. Yeah, very powerful. So I'm assuming, and again, coming back to Ed, you mentioned learning theories, that underpinning this framework are some learning theories. What are these learning to all three of you, either one of you, what are these learning theories?
So, for example, they work together, but oftentimes they sometimes can be seen in conflict. For example, implicit learning theories are a theory for implicit learning is that you learn without the intention to learn. You're learning by doing. You're learning by engaging in the environment. You're learning by engaging the task that's in front of you. And as coaches and as coaching scientists, we're encouraging coaches to try and coach to the environment, coach the task, manipulate that, and have the players engage with what manipulation you've put in front of them. To marry that with with implicit learning theories, there are explicit learning theories, which are how do we engage in that instruction? If and when we do instruct, let's make it really good instruction. And let's make sure that we're able to say what we need to say with as few words as possible. And I think that goes to a lot of the work that we mentioned earlier, that Nick's work about how do you, the construction of a cue. He's got a really, really good framework around cue anatomy. What are the things we want to do and need to know about what we want to say so that when we do say it, we say it really clearly, and that clear instruction innervates movement and innervates action without them having to think too much about what their body is doing, for example. And then the final theory that puts these two together would be the self-determination theory, which again would be very well known to your listeners. That idea of autonomy, relatedness, and connectedness. And how do we engage people in an environment where they feel like they belong, they feel like they're heard, and they also feel like they have they not only are heard and they have a voice, but they feel like they have something to offer in as well by their engagement.
Okay. So explicit learning, implicit learning, self-determination, and this framework is striving to explore the combination of the three. Am I right in saying that?
It is, and it does it through reflective practice. So one of the key principles of good coach education that is emerging over the last number of years and decades is that we need to be encouraging coaches to engage with the players that they work with through more questionings and in more interrogative processes. Resist the temptation to give them the answers. Resist the temptation to have a running commentary on what they're doing on the pitch. And when you do stop the play, ask them questions about their experiences. And that already triggers that self-regulation, self-reflective practice process, but also then for afterwards. When you're finished your session, how do you reflect on your practice?
A question for any of you. Explicit learning, implicit learning, explicit instruction. Is there a difference between explicit learning theory and explicit instruction, or do they go hand in hand? Are they built? Are they intertwined?
No, absolutely. So in terms of not just the instructions that you're giving, but the type of feedback that you're giving, and not only that, but when you're giving it to the athlete, are they actually capable of processing the message? Does the message mean to you what you want it to mean to the athlete, which is pretty important as well, because it might make perfect sense in your head, but does your athlete actually understand what you're trying to get them to do? And is that then offset by the amount of volume that it takes you to actually get the message across? If you're speaking every couple of seconds during a coaching session, is the athlete actually going to retain the explicit information that you're giving them, or do they just immediately drown it out? So, absolutely hand in hand for that, Dan.
And in terms of implicit learning theory, I think what I heard you guys say was that this framework very much encompasses a constraints led approach. There are other, my understanding is that there are other approaches to implicit learning, such as teaching games for understanding. Anything that's games based could be, my understanding, associated with a more implicit style of learning. I'm assuming that Nick and Matthew, obviously they came to you with the framework, so they chose to use a constraints led approach. Again, would I be correct in saying that?
Yeah, very much so. I think the one thing you will notice by all the authors on this paper, everyone's a coach. Everybody on the paper is a coach. Yes, some of us have an academic hat that we put on at different times of our day and our week. But at the end of it all of us are coaches, and probably all of us have experienced different stages of our coaching development when maybe we were very explicit in what we used to say and do. But because we're all engaged in coaching from an academic perspective, but also from a life perspective, it's a background, it's a pastime, but it's also a job, coaching, we also are aware of what best practice is telling us. You know, what is the evidence suggesting we should be doing? And it's not that a constraints-led approach is the only way, not at all. It's just that we need to be aware that there are implicit learning theories suggest to us that when we learn by doing, when we've actually time to figure something out, it may be a little slower in the uptake at the time, but the retention longer term is better because I learned through my experience and my exploration, as opposed to the learning being put on me and I've been told what to do, when to do it and how to do it. No, I've been given time and space to figure it out. And when it's not going well, the answers aren't forced on me. I'm actually, there's an inquisitive question that comes my way that helps me further engage with my experience.
We've spent some time on the Sports Site show unpacking games-based approaches, for instance, with Dr. Stephen Harvey. We've perhaps spoken about approaches that might be construed as slightly different. For instance, Dr. Nikki Hodges and Dr. Keith Lowe's coming on and talking about challenge point, for example. We've never really spoken that much about a constraints-based approach. And I'm very, very conscious that, you know, this is a significant part of this paper. So, you know, for those listening in, and I appreciate, again, there will be some who are listening in who will be familiar with the constraints-based approach. But, you know, a big part of this is guiding design. So, again, a question for all three of you, and perhaps this could spark a bit of a conversation here. What is a constraints-based approach? And what repercussions are there for my session design if I engage in a constraints-led approach in my coaching?
Yeah, so I suppose the first thing to say on a constraints-led approach to coaching is that a lot of coaches are actually doing this already, perhaps without even realizing that that's what they're doing. So the big thing to start off with in any coaching scenario is, what is the movement outcome or the performance goal that you're looking to attain at the end, and then work backwards in terms of your design of a training scenario. So, and again, rugby is the easy example in this paper, but it can be applied across any sport. For a constraints-led approach, you are constraining one element of a certain activity for a desired outcome within that activity. So that could be in an activity, it could be in a game, dare I say a drill, but you are constraining one movement for the benefit of trying to learn and perhaps progress on through to a different outcome. And that obviously is dependent on the athlete's training age, their development age, the complexity of the task that you're looking to that you're looking to achieve, the outcome goal, the numbers that you may have at a particular training session, all these variables that most people have at their disposal for any training session, they all feed into what you're trying to get out of at the end in terms of using a constraints-led approach. And within the paper, we utilize just four very, very simple, say, guidelines in turn, and they're by no means exhaustive. But if you are in a particular training example, there are certain things that you can manipulate to get an outcome. So the classic, if you want to promote a passing scenario in a basketball match, for example, you might put in a rule constraint where the players aren't allowed to dribble the ball. So they have to, by being constrained by the rules of that particular activity, they have to search out the pass. We can also manipulate the space of a playing area or a court or whatnot if we're looking for a different outcome. We can also manipulate the type of equipment that we use. So ball size, racket size, if we're in tennis, the height of a basket in basketball, the size of a goal, the time, space, rules, and equipment are the four that we talk about in the paper for that. So a lot of coaches actually naturally do this within their training scenarios, but possibly without the outcome goal or maybe understanding the full nuance of why they've implemented a particular constraint on an activity.
Well, they might just call it a condition.
Or a condition. Absolutely.
So what I'm hearing here is that if I constrain, so we're really talking under the umbrella term of implicit learning theory. I constrain a task in my session design. I constrain the movement of, for example, the movement of an athlete, constrain the environment, and perhaps that movement is constrained by the environment and by the task as well. Then the hypothesis of a constraints-led approach is that I may change behavior as a consequence of these constraints. Am I hearing that correctly in my very basic definition there?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Nail on the head with it.
I think one of the things that we should consider in these situations, and again, like Dan, you'll know this as a psychologist, when you look at some of the theories that we engage with in it from a behavioral perspective anyway, you look at Bandura's social cognitive theory, let's say. Change the environment, you know what, you're going to change how people behave in that environment. You change the behavior of people in an environment, you're going to change maybe the environment itself, because you're going to, because we, by our nature, we're incredibly interactive people. And what I think has happened or had happened over a period of decades in coaching was that it became very explicit and incredibly overly instruction-led, because we were trying to overly control the environment. And we forgot that human beings are incredibly interactive people. If it's cold outside, I will automatically zip up my jacket without much thought into it. If it's too warm, I'll take off a layer. We're constantly engaging with the environment around us. But when we went into a sporting environment, what tended to happen was we felt the need to over control. And what I think these theories are suggesting, and it's only suggesting because they're still they're theoretical, is that if we can actually take a little step back from the and remove the locus of control from the coach and put the locus of control on the task or the organism or the constraint, and then observe how players interact within that environment. So there's, as you know yourself, better than all of us, there are theories out there that suggest we're interactive in loads of different ways. And all I think what implicit learning theories suggest is, let's bring that interaction into the sporting environment a lot more, because there's so many things, as Kevin has outlined, there's so many things that we can manipulate in the sporting environment. And when we manipulate one, we change the environment, either in a small way or a large way, depending on how heavily we manipulate it.
Implicit learning theory heavily influencing session design. What I'm really intrigued to understand is how you're marrying that with an explicit learning design, with explicit learning theory. Where does the explicit learning marry up with the implicit learning theory? You've kind of alluded to language being a part here, so I'd like you to unpack that for me. That would be awesome. And I suppose there's a slight backdrop here. I'm a sad man. I think about this stuff far too much and listen to far too many podcasts and differences of opinions and stuff. And I have heard, for instance, somebody who's very keen on, let's say, the constraints-led approach, you know, literally talking about the difference between implicit and explicit being the difference between oil and water, that these things cannot marry up. And I'm always excited by marrying things up because I just think life is too complex not to, you know. So could you unpack how, in this framework, you've aligned implicit with explicit?
Yeah, so obviously enough, you want your session design and whatnot to be representative of the sport, whatever that may be, rugby, soccer, basketball, it doesn't matter. So you want the training environment to mirror what they're going to face in competition. That's not to say that the coach is going to stay silent the entire training session. It's a little unrealistic to expect that to be the case and not to offer any guidance to the athletes. All we're saying within the framework is that when you do need to intervene and perhaps ask a question or give direction or give feedback or give an instruction, that the language that you use in either volume or the type of language that you select with your athletes is as effective as possible in getting your coaching message across without, as Ed calls it, what do we call it, commentary during the training session, or joystick coaching, PlayStation coaching, whatever label you want to put on it, but that it is effective. And as kind of a small segue on it, my experience with that particular facet of coaching, I got quite a bit of a shock when I left college at 22 and then went to France with pretty much less than a bonjour. It was about the limit of my French in that scenario. So it meant that when I was actually coaching athletes, I had to plan the session to the nth degree, right down to the very words that I was going to use, translate the words into French because I was having to speak or having to coach the athletes through French, and then ultimately keeping that as short and succinct as possible because I then had to translate it through Google to make sure that my message got across. So the idea that messages are small and effective and succinct is one that appeals to me very much so. And the marriage between that and the implicit stuff, I think can be very, very effective.
Again, a question for all three of you. Could you give me some examples of what succinct, effective language might look like, might sound like?
Yeah, so within the paper, there's a little bit of it's kind of a sub framework within that in terms of of cue anatomy, of how you can actually describe something as succinctly as possible, depending on whatever outcome you're looking for. So within your coaching message, it's Nick Winkelmann's model of, say, the three Ds to be included in any effective cue. So we want the cue to have a distance, a direction, and a description verb. So for example, within the paper, we use the example of the tackle. So the coach will identify to the athletes first what a successful outcome will look like, and then address any deficits based on what they're going to say. So that might look like a successful tackle is when I drive the opponent back towards their try line. And we may use then a description word like, say, smash, for example, implying, say, a high force contact. So instead of just saying tackle the opponent, push them back, we give the description, the direction, and the distance. So smash the opponent back towards the opposition try line as a very, very simple example.
Description wise, using metaphor.
Absolutely. And there's a little section in it as well where we talk about the use of analogies. So glide like a torpedo, for example, if we are swimming, if we were performing some form of a jumping task, if I tell the athlete to explode upwards towards the sky, no one thinks of an explosion as being slow or whatnot. It's a very kind of high force output word. So the use of analogies, and they're very region specific as well, which is again another aspect that allows the coach to personalize their language with their athletes, something that can be understood.
You asked the question, Dan, about the marriage of the two learning theories, and I think you've hit the nail on the head with metaphor, or the term that Kevin used, analogy. That is the best example of how these theories merge and marry together. Why? Because you can't give an analogy without words, but if the analogy can be so succinct and concise, then that will in itself cause an implicit behavior to emerge. So if I'm asking someone to do a box jump onto a platform in a gym, but I want them to control their landing, I'm going to say to them, I want you to land like a butterfly. That immediately has an impact on how they land. Now, I don't have to talk to them about what I want. I've just created that picture, that metaphor, that analogy, land like a butterfly. And I think that's the ingenuity of some of the work that Nick put forward, because in the description or the anatomy of that cue was to determine, you know, how far away am I from this? So what do I need to, what's the right analogy to do this? Or what direction do I want them to go in, and how do I want them to get them there? I don't want to spend all day describing the situation. I don't want to drown them out with over-instruction. But if I can identify and come up with a really strong action verb and embed it in an analogy, it saves me a huge amount of coaching time, and it increases the efficiency of the interaction between coach and athlete.
It offers short chunks of phenomenological experience.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Subjective experience.
Yeah, because I'm not too sure if there's anybody in the world who would not know what landing like a butterfly means. It's something that it immediately interests our imagination. Butterflies don't land heavy, is what we're saying. So I don't need to say to you, land heavy and get your foot here. And all of a sudden I'm getting them thinking about their body. And I'm getting them to think about their body in a way that we know from Gabrielle Wolf's work and so on and so forth, that's not as conducive to freeing the degrees of freedom and so on and so forth. But what we do want is we want them to maybe try and attach their movement to an image that they feel, oh yeah, that's something that represents what they want me to do. And also I can connect to it myself. And now let's see what my body produces when I have that in my mind.
This side of things really resonates with me because a lot of my work utilizes metaphor. I borrow from a different person, Yuri Hannin, the Norwegian psychologist who... did a lot of work in emotion, motivation in sport, and came up with the theoretical count of individual zones of optimal functioning. And you can very much utilize metaphor to drive mental states, playing like a lion, as quick as a leopard, and things like that. So absolutely evokes mental states in short, quick chunks. So you know, Ed, how I talk to you a lot about game face and stuff like that. So it's very, very similar. A question I had here was, because we're talking a lot about movement stuff, and I understand, for instance, that tactics, game strategies, game models that help teams exploit, say, principles of play, are important in the coaching process. You're talking a lot about movement and stuff like that. I understand movement is involved in tactical acquisition and execution, but can this framework account for tactics? How do you take this, that combination between the implicit and the explicit, and utilize this for instance, tactical development and tactical execution?
Yeah, I suppose that primarily will align with our implicit learning theories, Dan, and I suppose the manipulation of the environment or the task can be suited to develop the tactical element that you might be looking to work with. And I suppose key within that then is, I suppose, the role, the facilitator type role of the coach, with a guided discovery, with the player interactions to maybe support optimal learning. And I think that's where the tactical elements will grow. And I think that the whole thing here, it's really about developing and evaluating. And that's our job, really, to evaluate. But we're very excited by this, but it is to evaluate it. But it is almost a philosophical approach to developing coaches. And Kevin often gives the example of teaching a man to fish as opposed to giving him a bucket of fish, you know, and that's what we're trying to do here, as opposed to giving coaches lots of little drills and activities are running a model session and you come back three months later and they're still delivering the same session, the goal here is that we're trying to support coaches to develop the tactical nuances, as you ask there, but whatever elements they have the skill set and the repertoire in their toolbox to apply and develop what they're trying to develop.
Kevin, Ed, anything to add to what Con said there? Thanks, Con.
I think he hit the nail on the head, because I think what that speaks to is we appreciate in sport that patterns emerge. We can't get away from that. You know, we look at the World Cup that's on right now. Teams set up in a 4-4-2, in a 3, in a 3-5-2, in a 4-3-2-3. You know what I mean? And that has an impact on how we respond to it. If you're expecting teams to go out there without a tactical preparation, without some appreciation of what the opposition might do, where we can recognize, oh, they're setting up this way, that may lead to the following behaviors, I think you're missing a major aspect of performance and performance psychology. And I think that's, as Con was saying, these approaches are this philosophy, and I love that use of this word here, because we're just trying to encourage coaches to engage in a philosophy of how they coach, not what it is they do while they're coaching, but how they coach, so that any philosophy, the very nature of the word philosophy is that it will evolve. But unfortunately, what we see from the evidence and from other papers is that coach education currently doesn't do a good job of providing people with a philosophy that will evolve over time. It's a real, here's your box of tricks, go away and do that. Now, we won't assess it, and we might assess it one day, but you know what? We're not going to assess it long term, because, hey, we can't. But you've done enough to get your cert here today. Well done, and off you go. And I know from talking with Nick and Matt, they fundamentally weren't happy with that as a journey for coaches to as they go through coach education. And I think it's important to know Matt Wilkie has since moved on and moved back to Australia to do similar work with Australian rugby. And he's been now replaced in the role by Dr. Dara Sheridan, who, again, another person who's coming into this place about coach education with a huge interest on developing an evolving philosophy for coaches. Not that I've done my level one, I'm now done as a coach. No. That's not the purpose of coach education, because education in any domain is something that should evolve with time. And the more we learn about it, the more we get intrigued by it. And you know the phrase that coach will talk about. The longer I coach, the more I realize I know a lot less. But when I was younger and I had read just one book, I thought I knew it all. But the more I read, the more I realize I know so much less than I once thought I did. Why? Because your philosophy evolves. And that's what I like about what Con said here. The way the structure of a coach education framework like this provides people with tools that will enable them to adapt for whatever is happening in front of them. Not a case of, I only have a set of tools, and if it's not happening in front of me, I don't know where to go. So I'm just going to keep doing what I always do. No, I need to be able to adapt to the demands in front of me. And that leads us to the research that Kevin did. When we evaluated this framework, it was evaluated with children's rugby, so junior rugby. It was evaluated with adolescents in a school setting. It was also evaluated with adults. So across different domains to determine, well, does a coach education framework like this impact change on people's behaviours as coaches?
Before we get on to answering that question, you mentioned that magic word psychology, Ed. I think it's a magic word. And I know that there will be lots of sports psychologists listening in screaming at me for not having more of a conversation around, I suppose, the third underpinning theory here, which is self-determination theory. We've talked a lot about explicit and implicit learning. Really, as a psychologist, I should be going straight for the self-determination theory. So, Kevin, can you unpack that a little bit? So we've got implicit learning, we've got explicit learning. You're doing something in terms of trying to combine those in this framework. And then you're also trying to draw on self-determination theory. We've spoken quite a bit about self-determination theory, as you can imagine, on the Sports Psych Show. But just unpack for us, Kevin, how you draw on that within this framework.
Yeah, so the the theory itself is, it's and you've talked about it a little bit already, but it's a meta theory of motivation and well-being. It primarily focuses around the athlete's self-determined autonomy, so that they have some control over their environment. In this case, we're talking about a training or a coaching environment, that they perceive that they have the competence to complete whatever training task it is that they're being asked of by their coach. And then finally, the relatedness piece, which is, can they actually make a connection or the relationship with the coach or the other athletes that they're participating in their coaching scenario with. And I suppose the best way of to describe it in terms of a coaching environment, again, like the implicit learning theories, a lot of coaches will already be doing quite a lot of the elements of this. So it's not like we're reinventing the wheel and bringing out something totally off the ball and out there that coaches aren't doing. Like, some coaches may very well be doing some of these elements within their sessions already that are promoting that self-determination theory within their athletes, you know? So I give a couple of examples in the paper in terms of autonomy, for example, for the athletes. It could be something as simple as, at the start of the session, guys or girls, where you're going to do, say, tackling and shooting today, which would you like to do first? So that the athletes there have some form of control over their own environment, you know? And there's a couple of simple examples like that that coaches perhaps could integrate into their current practices to better align the theory to their practice, you know?
I've written down a few words here as you've been speaking: the importance of involvement, engagement, players having skin in the game, offering choice. I suppose as a sports psychologist, I would look towards complex learning theory. We have spoken about this on the Sports Psych Show before. Social constructivism, cognitive constructivism, which all suggest that from an educational standpoint, that player involvement, if we're talking about sport, is important. It helps them. It builds relationship. It helps them experience competence and that sense of autonomy. That's essentially what I'm personally hearing there.
Yeah, and I think in a lot of this type of coach education work, I think it was an area that was almost assumed would develop naturally. And I think it's heartening and great to see this being front and center of this framework, because I think, you know, the longer I'm involved in coaching, the importance of relationships, I think, can't be overplayed. And I think having a strong emphasis on that and the development of same is has the potential to greatly inform this model, which we're looking at in a rugby setting. But I think the other thing about this model is that it has the potential to go across sport, you know, irrespective of the sport. So yeah, I think it's great to see it within the model.
If I may, Dan, there's two things just to pick up on what the lads have said there. The first is, Kevin said, we're not suggesting that coaches don't do any of these things, but what this framework has asked of us to evaluate it is to see if we can steer coaches towards just better coaching. Because coaches are out there already out there doing their best, but oftentimes with maybe a lack of awareness. And that's when Kevin started evaluating this process on with boots on the ground and recording all sessions, audio and video and so on and so forth, and then having coaches listening back and hearing themselves. That awareness is a huge part of any coach's journey. When you finally become aware of what you were doing, and when you finally start engaging in reflective practice to consider what you were doing. Because as Khan said, then that second point about relationships, you may have an idea about how you are currently building these relationships with people, and how you feel you are supporting them in developing their autonomy and so on and so forth. But it's only when you maybe look at your coaching, hear your coaching, and have someone challenge your coaching that you realize, okay, it's okay, but I can do better. Now, how can I do better? And it's the how is so key here. not what should I do? And okay, I've just ticked that box, I'm done. No, no, no. How can you connect with someone more? How can you draw themselves out of themselves to contribute more into a session? And it comes back as concept that those relationships are key. The more someone coaches, what they should be finding is that they get closer to the people they're working with to find out even more about them so that they can be even better in how they coach them. Not make it get a further distance from them and be more remote from them and not know what is required. And I think that's where self-determination theory with the other two theories, the implicit and explicit learning theories, that's where it can, it's the glue between the other two, essentially, self-determination theory.
The paper we've been talking about is a review of theoretical approaches that underpin this framework. But at the moment, Kevin, you're engaged in follow-up studies. You're getting feedback right now from coaches who are utilizing this framework. To round things off today, tell us a little bit about what conversations you're having, what coaches are experiencing utilizing the frameworks, perhaps just a little bit on advantages, disadvantages, challenges and strengths. It'd be great to bring us up to date.
Yeah, so again, we talked at the beginning of the podcast about how this was a review of the theoretical aspect of the coach education framework, but we're also very, very interested, as you can probably tell, in the practical application of the framework with coaches that are, you know, from grassroots all the way up. So we decided then to have a look at what are the coaches actually doing first to begin with. We give them the intervention and then we have a look at and see if that actually changes their behaviors and their perceptions or the perceptions of their athletes. So say our initial observation with the coaches involved us videoing their training sessions with a microphone. We then coded their coaching behaviors using Professor Cushion's tool, the coaching analysis intervention system for behaviors, which will then give us a profile, if you will, of each coach and what they're doing in each session. And then as we build that up through a couple of training sessions, you get a truer picture of, say, objectively speaking, what the coaches are doing. How often are they instructing in a training session? Do they give feedback? If they give feedback, what's the proportion of the feedback? Is it general? Is it specific? Is it positive or is it negative? Are they asking questions of their athletes? So all of the kind of key attributes that we're talking about within, say, the framework of, be it language, how are they designing their training sessions? How do they spend their time? We're looking at that in a practical sense and then trying to see if we can elicit any kind of a change between pre-intervention with the framework and then post-intervention. And it's interesting to say the least, you know.
And any exciting differences seeing or any kind of insights that you can share with us that the coaches are having?
Well, at the moment mentioned earlier, we're looking across, we're going the full gambit in terms of we're looking from adult to adolescent to child. Either surprisingly or unsurprisingly, we're seeing that a lot of instructional type coaching where there's high volumes of those types of behaviors within their athletes, and that's across from child, adolescent to adult. I haven't actually sent the paper on to the lads for review just yet, but one of the cohorts, actually, interestingly enough, from pre and post, the behaviors that were actually altered were their feedback type behaviors. So they maintained the same level of instruction, the same level of management type behaviors, but their feedback behaviors were altered. And within their feedback behaviors, and they all increased, before you ask, they all increased, but a lot of it was what we would deem negative feedback to the athletes. So pointing out, say, errors that the athletes were making. And the interesting thing with that is that the only feedback behavior that didn't change was the positive specific feedback. So the affirmation type information that one would assume you would like to give to an athlete if they do something well. So loved your positioning in the last tackle, excellent strike through the ball, that kind of thing. So that was the only feedback behaviour that hadn't been altered pre and post intervention of the coach education framework.
So. Brilliant. Well, we'll definitely have to get you back on and talk in greater depth about some of the feedback that you're experiencing as a consequence of intervening with this framework. Gents, it's just been a fantastic conversation. I've really enjoyed it. For me, it just demonstrates how coaching is. It's a wonderful hobby or profession, but it's complicated, isn't it? Difficult. It's challenging. It's wonderful, but difficult and challenging.
Wonderful but difficult, I think, just about sums it up perfectly.
But I think, just if I may, Dan, just to finish, I think it's important. What we made a strong effort in this review is to write it for the coaches, and you'll see throughout the paper there are lots and lots of practical applications and examples. And I think oftentimes, especially in reviews of literature, especially when it's a theoretical focus, it can be very theoretical. So I think the challenge or the ambition we had for this was to write it for coaches, and that coaches can read it and understand it and make and use it to apply it to their own practice. So I think that's important.
Which is a wonderful segue to asking Kevin where people can find this review paper.
So it's published in the International Journal of Sports Science and Coaching and is available online at the moment. If anyone would like to email me either as well, I can pass on my email to you, Dan, and anyone that wants to get in touch, I'm more than happy to send them a copy as well.
Well, would you like to tell us your email, Kevin?
kevin.smith1@mycit.ie.
Perfect. Con, how can people follow you, get hold of you if you'd like to be gotten hold of?
Yeah, so I suppose, again, like Kevin, my email is similar. I'm con.burns@mtu.ie, and, I'm in the office most of the time, so feel free to drop an email at any stage.
And Dr. Ed Coughlan, how can people follow you and get in contact?
Yeah, edward.coughlan@mtu.ie. I probably previously would have been on Twitter at Dr. Skillack. I am there now, but I'm there a lot more, a lot less frequently. I find it to be an utterly unhelpful place a lot of the time. Some really ridiculously unhelpful conversations and discussions going on between people who think they have an opinion that everyone should hear about. So I go in there very carefully nowadays, maybe once a week. Today, in fact,
it's a Friday. Yeah, I seem to. There's a pattern. Yeah.
A pattern. But that's just more, and that's just more for my own well-being, Dan. But no, people can get in touch on social media. I'm there on at Dr. Skillack if people want to reach out. But it might be, if they get in touch on a Saturday, they won't hear from me probably till the following Friday.
Well, gents, I can't thank you enough for your time. That's a really, really interesting conversation. So thank you so much.
Thanks, Dan.
Thanks a million, Dan.
Appreciate it.
Well, everybody, I really enjoyed that conversation, and I hope you did too. If you do have any feedback, please get in contact via Twitter or Facebook or through my website, danabrahams.com. I'm already looking forward to next week's episode. Bye for now.